atoning sacrifice, keeper of this life. Hallelujah, you are Savior, beginning and the end, forgiver of my sin. By your mercy, you have saved us. Jesus, you are stronger, more than any other. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Jesus, you are higher, my soul's deepest desire. Hallelujah, you are Savior. You are the Shepherd King. You lead us by still waters. Hallelujah, you are Savior. You are my only hope. Your kindness is my friend. In your presence, you restore us. Jesus, you are stronger, more than any other. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Jesus, you are higher, my soul's deepest desire. Hallelujah, you are Savior. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are my joy, stood in my place, taking my shame. Upon your shoulders, Jesus, you are stronger, more than any other. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Jesus, you are higher, my soul's deepest desire. Hallelujah, you are Savior. You.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. What a Savior. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Well, welcome to Calvary Baptist. I'm glad you're all kind of squeezing in here, and more people will come in as the service progresses. So we're just glad to see you all. It's nice air conditioning room. We can be together praising the Lord. I just want to draw your attention that we do have a bulletin. If you didn't get one, make sure you get one and ask Peter back there or one of the ushers that walking around, and if you'd like to communicate something to us, there's a little tear-off thing here. You can tear it off, put a little, any kind of decision that you make today, any kind of prayer request that you have, and you can fold it, put your information on it first, then fold it, and put it in the offering plate when that comes by. Amen? Easy instructions. We try to make it as easy as possible. So as we continue our worship time, I want to invite you to turn in your Bibles, or you can just look up there on the screen, Isaiah 53. I'm going to read verses 1 through 6, because today the message that we're going to hear is God's testimony, what God says about his own son. It's in 1 John chapter 5, but we'll get to that later on. But Isaiah 53 was written thousands of years before Christ actually walked on this earth. It's a prophecy concerning his life. And so I like to read it, and you'll see how it so vividly describes what Jesus did for us. And so we want to exalt Christ. As a matter of fact, after we do this, we're going to sing that song, Exalted. Amen? Amen? It's a wonderful song. Listen to the word of the Lord as we continue our worship time. Who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. And starting in verse 3, he is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken and smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. What a powerful, powerful description of what took place to Jesus on that cross. There he hung, and God took all of our sins and placed it on him. It's a wonderful message of God's grace to mankind. And so we come to worship the Lord today, and I pray that those scriptures were a blessing to you. Join with me as I ask the Lord to bless this service. Father, I thank you so much. Thank you for this reminder from Isaiah 53 that you've given to us such a clear description of who Jesus your Son is and the Messiah who has come as the Savior of the world and what happened to him, how he was rejected and despised, and how he you laid on him our iniquity, our sins. And so as Jesus hung there on that cross, he was a sacrifice for our sins. And God, we can never repay you for that. We can just worship you and thank you for it. And most importantly, as your word says, that we can believe, we can trust that sacrifice for our sins so that we can be forgiven and spend all eternity with you. We pray that we would all believe that message, the gospel, that Christ died for sinners, was buried, and rose again. And by believing in that, we would all have life, eternal life, and be with you forever. God, I pray that you would bless this service. You would bless those who are watching the service from home. And you would bless those who are trying to get here on time and to worship with us. We pray for safety for them. We pray, God, that all those who are here, all of us, would be able to enjoy your presence, worshiping you as we sing unto you and as we hear from your word a little bit later on. We ask your blessing in Jesus' name. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Hey, why don't you turn around and greet somebody, look for someone who might be a visitor.
We won't be here next Sunday. I already told Pete.
Hey, Pam. How you doing? How Michaela do, all right? Is that right? How you feeling? Okay? All right. You cool with the outline and all that? Thank you.
Say
If you'd like to follow with me as we read God's Word together, I'll be reading from page 348 in the Pew Bible. Let's read Psalm 118, verses 14 to 21. And this carries along with the theme that Pastor was reading. The Lord is my strength and song. He has become my salvation, the voice of rejoicing, and salvation is in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness. I will go through them, and I will praise the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous shall enter. I will praise you, for you answered me and have become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
Again on earth, cause cause your church to hunger for your ways. Let the fragrance of our prayers arise. Lead us on the road of sacrifice, that in unity the face of Christ will be clear for all the world to see.
You may all be seated as you prepare to receive God's word this morning.
All righty. Well, praise the Lord. Any other little ones want to go? Anybody want to be a little person? All right, you're stuck with me. Well, I invite you to open your Bibles to 1 John chapter 5, verses 6 to 12. It's page 709 in the Pew Bible. If you don't have a Bible, you do now, because that Pew Bible that you're holding, you can have as a gift from us to you. And we just want to make sure everybody has a copy of God's Word. I will be teaching from verses 6 to 12, and the reason why I am doing this, after I read this, you will say, you know, I wouldn't have chosen these verses to preach on. It's a difficult verses. But we're going through 1 John, and I can't skip it. Otherwise, you guys would say, hey, Pastor, why are you skipping verses 6 to 12? What's wrong with those verses? You don't like those verses? And I wouldn't want to hear that. So we're going through God's word. We're not just going through like a buffet cafeteria style and skipping the broccoli. All right? We're going to look at these verses and me too. I was just saying that for one or two people in here that don't like green vegetables. All right? So anyway. 1 John chapter 5. Verses 6 to 12, and then we'll have a word of prayer. Listen to the word of the Lord. God's word says, this is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not only by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree as one. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater, for this is the witness of God which he has testified of his Son. He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God has given of his Son. And this is the testimony, that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. So those are some interesting scriptures, aren't they not? They're difficult, but yet they're a blessing. We're going to dig into those today. And because they're a little difficult, I always pray before I preach, but even more so today, I think we should pray and ask God to bless this to our life. So join me in prayer. Father, I thank you so much for the opportunity, the blessing that I have to stand here before these people. But it's also a sober an occasion that we stand here before your presence, O God. And as we want to hear from you, these are your words written on these pages, and we pray that you will give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to understand the truth of thy word, that all of us would benefit from these words, that you would be glorified, that we would be edified, and that we would go forth out of this place sharing the wonderful truth that we've learned. I ask you to work through me. I ask for you to make us all good hearers. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. And so, as we've been going through this book that we're studying together, 1 John, I like to keep on reminding you that 1 John was written to these believers here in Asia Minor and was written for the purpose of giving assurance to the believers there in Asia Minor. In other words, all of 1 John that we've been looking at is given to the church throughout all of church history, but especially as he's writing these words to the first church that he wrote them to give them assurance so that they can know for sure that their sins are forgiven, that they have eternal life, that if they were to die right now, they would be in heaven with God forever and ever. It's a wonderful thing to know and to have that kind of assurance. That's what 1 John is written for. I've written these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God that you may know, not hope so, but it's that you know that you have eternal life. So it's written for that reason, but it's also written to declare who the person of Jesus Christ is. And the reason why John had a right to declare who the person of Jesus Christ is was because there was heretical teachers who had infiltrated the church back in this time when this book was written, and they were teaching that Jesus was only the Christ at his baptism and his ministry. He had the power to do things. But when Jesus went to the cross, the man Jesus, the Spirit of Christ left him. And so it was only the person of Jesus who died on that cross. It wasn't the Messiah. Now, we have a problem with that. I hope you understand there's a problem with that. Because if Jesus Christ is not the Messiah, if he's not the Savior who has come to save us from our sins, then that means we're still in our sins. That means there's no hope. That means the Messiah is still yet to come, right? But because Jesus Christ is the Savior, and that death on the cross was for our sins, we can now all have the opportunity to be forgiven of our sins. And so this message that we're looking at this morning is God's testimony. God is going to give us a testimony. He's going to pull six witnesses before us. And in a way, he's going to put six witnesses on a witness stand for us to look at on who the person of Jesus Christ is. Because it's of utmost importance that we get Jesus right. Jesus, you have to get him right. If you get Jesus wrong and you don't believe who he is and what he's done, you will spend all eternity separated from God because you got that wrong. And so God goes to great extent to show us who Jesus is. All of these pages, every page in the Bible is written so that we can know who Jesus is, because God wants us to have eternal life and to be with him forever and ever. And so this morning we'll look at God's testimony of his Son. There are certain evidences, or in this case testimonies, that one can look at to know that Jesus is truly the Son of God. These testimonies should be looked at as being enough to convince those who are being drawn by faith to know who Christ is. They are both external evidences, meaning there's going to be objectable historical facts that are in these verses that we're looking at that God has given to the world so that they can see who Jesus Christ is. But they're also, with those objective historical facts, there are also internal evidences, subjective experiences that a person can experience in their own heart to know for sure that this testimony is true. Now, according to the law in Deuteronomy 19, one's testimony is received as truth if there are two or three witnesses. Okay? And in this way, we accept the truthfulness of one's testimony. The passage that we look at this morning is not man's testimony. It is God's testimony. And if we believe man's testimony according to the law, how much more so should we believe God's testimony? God has never lied to us. We must accept God's testimony because it says in our text that God is greater than man. God is greater than man. God is greater than man because God is more powerful than man. God is greater than man because God is wiser than man. But most importantly, God is greater than man because God can be trusted. And all of God's scriptures, all of God's truth is true. In fact, to not believe God's testimonies regarding Jesus, as our text said, as I read a little while ago, would be to call God a liar. verse 10 says this, "He who does not believe God has made him a liar because he has not believed the testimony that God has given of his son." So look with me at God's word at verse 6. Notice how he begins. He says, "This is he who came by water and blood," and then he names him Jesus Christ. Back in chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, over and over again, it was pushing us and calling us to believe in Jesus the Christ. And when a person believes that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, that person is born again. Or as it says there in chapter 5, verse 1, they are born of God. Not only are you born of God when you believe that Jesus is the Christ, but you also become an overcomer. You become an overcomer because Christ makes you an overcomer and you overcome the things of this world. It's a wonderful, wonderful truth that this is he, Jesus, the only one that God sent to be the Savior of the world. He has come. He's always existed. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Jesus, the Son of God, has always existed, but he took on human flesh, and it says that he came. He came into this world, and what did he come to do? To seek and to save that which was lost, to save us from our sins. And so God is going to bring 6 witnesses to the witness stand to confirm who his Son, Jesus the Christ, is. And the first witness he brings to the stand is the witness of his baptism, the witness of his baptism. Here in our passage of Scripture, it says, "This is he who came by water and blood." Jesus Christ, not only by water, but by water and blood. Now, I told you I would have probably not picked this passage to teach, right? Because if you look at those scriptures in verse 6, what in the world is he talking about, water and blood? All of church history has interpreted these verses differently, okay? We're talking back all the way back to Augustine. Augustine looked at that phrase, "This is he who came by water and blood," and he interpreted that the water and blood was when a Roman soldier came to Jesus when he was hanging on the cross and he pierced him in the side, and what came out of his body? Water and blood, John 19:34. That's how Augustine interpreted this. Then later on, we have the reformers, Martin Luther and John Calvin. As they looked at these verses, they would say, "No, it's not that. It most likely is talking about the sacraments, the baptism and the Lord's table, that the cup of blood that we celebrate the Lord's death." And that's how Luther and Calvin would interpret it. And then later on, more people began to look at these verses, and the majority of people today look at the water and the blood and say it is talking about Jesus' baptism when he began his ministry. That would be the water. And then the blood would be speaking of his crucifixion. That is the way I see it. And the reason why I see it that way, the reason why other people see it that way, is because contextually, I use the big word, I'm sorry, all right? Contextually, it means that if you look and study the context of why 1 John was written, it's written to refute the false teachers who were misrepresenting who Jesus was. And so John is saying that he didn't just come by water, but he came by blood. Jesus was the Christ at his baptism, but he was also the Christ at the crucifixion. He came by water, but he also came by blood. So he's speaking of Jesus' baptism. So God is pulling forward the witness of the baptism. Something happened at Jesus' baptism that would identify Jesus as the Savior and the Messiah, that he came through water for all to see. And we can read of this in Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 to 17. Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 to 17. It says this, "Then Jesus came from Galilee to John," this is John the Baptist, "at the Jordan to be baptized by him. And John the Baptist tried to prevent Jesus from being baptized, saying, 'Wait a minute, I need to be baptized by you, and you are coming to me.'" See, John looked, he knew who Jesus was. He's the Lamb of God, the pure, spotless Lamb of God. And he says, "I'm not even worthy to wear the same sandals that Jesus wears. No way, I can't baptize you." And Jesus says to him in verse 15, Jesus answered and said to him, "Permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." And then he allowed him. And listen to this, verse 16 and following. "And when he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And verse 17, and suddenly a voice came from heaven. Wonder whose voice that is. Came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And so we have the witness of Jesus' baptism. God is declaring to the world and all those who were there who Jesus is. And so these verses that we're looking at, they tell us, those verses tell us why Jesus was baptized. Now, obviously, Jesus wasn't baptized because he was a sinner. John's baptism was called a baptism of repentance. Not the same kind of baptism that you and I have today when we pull out behind these curtains, if you didn't know, or a big tank that we baptize because we're Baptists, right? We like to baptize people. But our baptism is called a believer's baptism. After a person believes in Christ, then they should go through the waters of baptism. Well, Jesus is not a sinner, right? He doesn't need to be baptized in the same way that you and I do. And so this baptism that John is doing are for sinners to come. And as John is preaching, they're believing that what John is saying, that the kingdom of God is at hand. God is beginning his kingdom. And if you believe that the Messiah is going to come on the scene, and if you believe that you're a sinner, then you are to go to the baptism of repentance. So here comes Jesus. And John says, no, I can't baptize you. This is a baptism for sinners to repent. And Jesus says to permit it now. And what Jesus is doing, he's coming on the scene to identify with to the world and saying, I am the Messiah. I've come to be the Messiah, to show the world I am the Messiah. So listen to this. In a sense, Jesus did not belong at this baptism. Is that not true? He didn't belong there because he's not a sinner. In the same way, Jesus did not belong on the cross because he's not a sinner. In both events, God is declaring to the world that this is my son. He's identifying himself with sinners and believe that God is bringing forth Jesus as the Savior of the world. I love how this goes. Our Lord's baptism says this. Our Lord's baptism says, look, it says, look at the Holy Spirit of God descending upon him and anointing him. But it also says this, listen. Listen to the voice of the Father and his announcement concerning him. Jesus was not a mere man. He is the Son of God, who is the Lamb of God, who has come to take away the sins of the world. Amen? And so God is bringing forth the water, the baptism, to show that Jesus Christ is truly the Son of God. He brings forth the baptism and he says this, believe. Believe God's testimony of who his son is at his baptism. Secondly, we see that there's also the witness of the crucifixion. Notice in verse 6 that John repeats. He says, this is he who came by water. The word blood is repeated 3 times, not only by water, but by blood. He's repeating it. Now, why is he repeating it? Well, the false teachers had no problem believing that Jesus was the Christ at the baptism. They did have a problem believing that Jesus was the Christ at the cross. The Spirit of God had left him. And so he's repeating, he's not only equally the Son of God and the Messiah at his baptism, but he's also equally the Son of God at his crucifixion as well. Jesus is the Savior. He began his ministry at his baptism, but that ministry led to the cross, the bloody cross, where he suffered and died, shedding his blood for all mankind to be saved. And so the question we ask is, how is the cross a testimony of who Christ is? How is God showing the world that Jesus Christ is the Savior by putting him on a cross? Well, Jesus' death on the cross was a fulfillment of prophecy. Right from the beginning of the Bible in Genesis chapter 3, all throughout the prophets, all throughout the scriptures, God was declaring that his Messiah would come, his Savior would come, that he would come and not just be a king, but he would also be a suffering servant. And that's why I read that passage in Isaiah 53 to show you that Jesus is a fulfillment of prophecy. And God had put him forth, not only at the water, but also the blood of Christ being shed from that cross, Isaiah 53. Jesus even pointed this out to 2 men who were on the road to Emmaus, that he fulfilled prophecy. In Luke chapter 24, verses 26 to 27, Jesus says this, Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and enter into glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them in all the scriptures concerning him. You see that verse? Leave it up there for a moment. That verse is clearly showing that Jesus sees and understands that all of the scriptures, all of these Old Testament verses that we know in 39 books of the Old Testament, they all talk about Jesus who is going to come and be the Messiah. And God is putting him on the cross to show him that he is a fulfillment of all of these prophecies. Not only that, guys, check this out. God is also showing that Jesus was the Messiah, because while Jesus was on the cross, the Father demonstrated that Jesus was the Christ through various signs and miracles. In Matthew chapter 27, verses 51 to 54, we have the creation responding to what God is doing to Jesus on the cross. I don't know if you've ever read this before, but in Matthew 27, verses 51 to 54, there was darkness that crossed the land from the sixth to the ninth hour, which would be noon until 3 o'clock. Then the curtain of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. Then a number of Old Testament saints were raised and appeared to many as the first fruits of the resurrected life to all who would trust in Jesus. And then the Roman centurion, the soldier who was watching all of this and witnessing it, he sees all these things taking place and he says, "Whoa, truly, truly, this was the Son of God." And so God was given that as a witness. And then lastly, Jesus didn't stay dead. His resurrection is further proof that God sent Jesus as the Christ. He didn't stay dead. In Psalm 16, God's word promises that he would not allow his Holy One, his Messiah, to see decay. His body would not see decay. And so Jesus was raised to life. And so God brings forth the water. He brings forth the blood as testimonies concerning who his Son is. And God's word says this to you and I: believe. Believe God's testimony concerning his Son at the cross. Thirdly, we have the witness of the Spirit. Look at God's word in verse 6. He says, "It is the Spirit who bears witness because the Spirit is truth." It is the Spirit who bears witness because the Spirit is truth. So not only does the water and the blood bear witness of who Jesus of Nazareth is, but John says the Spirit also bears witness. Well, how's that? Well, the Spirit is the third person of the Trinity: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit has a role. He has a role. He has a job to do. And his primary job regarding Jesus is simple. It's simple. He is to point people to Jesus, to open up people's eyes to whom Jesus Christ really is. And so in John 16, 14, Jesus says, "When the Spirit comes, he will glorify me, he will take what is mine, and he will declare it to you." Much of what the Holy Spirit does is not seen with our eyes, right? We don't see it with our eyes. Much of what the Holy Spirit does is being done internally. It's being done in the hearts and minds of people. He came to convict the world of sin, judgment, and righteousness. He's come to convict the world because there is a truth. There is something that is true that people need to understand. He's called the Spirit of Truth. So he takes what is true and he convinces people of it. He takes what is true and he convinces people to believe what God's word says of Jesus. That is the Holy Spirit's role. So listen, if Jesus Christ was not the way, the truth, and the life, the Holy Spirit would not be working in the ministry of Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit would not be doing miracles through the life of Jesus Christ. But the Spirit of God was working all of these things and working in people's hearts. You know why? Because the Holy Spirit agrees. If you look at your Bible, and these verses 7 and 8, they're not in all translations, okay? But they are in the King James and the New King James. And some people believe that these two verses are not in the original manuscript. It's way too technical and too high for my pay grade, all right? But basically, what I'm saying is these are really important verses that teach about the Trinity. Now, if we didn't have these verses in the Bible, if you look at verse 7 and 8, if we didn't have those verses, that wouldn't mean we wouldn't believe in a Trinity, right? Because there's so many other scriptures that talk about the Trinity, right? So if these one verses were not really in the manuscripts and really God's word, it would not do anything to the doctrine that God, the Holy Spirit, is truly God. But saying all that, the Holy Spirit agrees with the testimonies of God. If you look at, there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And if you look down at verse 8, and there are three that bear witness on the earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree as one. And so the reason why the Holy Spirit was working through the person of Jesus Christ, because he is truly God's anointed one. He is God's Messiah. He is the Messiah that's come to save us from our sins. And the Holy Spirit is testifying to that truth. Amen? And then John 15, 26, Jesus says this, that when the Holy Spirit comes, the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, what will the Holy Spirit do? He will testify of me. That's what the Holy Spirit would do. The Spirit of God testifies of what is true. And how did he do that? Well, we saw so far in Matthew chapter 3 that the Spirit of God testified of who Jesus was at his baptism. When the Holy Spirit, what did he do? He came upon Jesus. And then you heard the voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." The Holy Spirit would never have come upon Jesus if he was not truly the Messiah. And then the Holy Spirit testified of who Jesus is, as he worked through the life of the apostles. In Acts chapter 2, we have the wonderful pouring out of the Holy Spirit upon the apostles. And over 3,000 people were converted and became believers in Christ. And then the Holy Spirit worked through these apostles to declare to all mankind that Jesus is the Christ, and he's still doing the same thing today as God's word is faithfully being proclaimed through pulpits all over the world. As God's word is being proclaimed and people exalt who Jesus Christ is, the Holy Spirit is working and testifying who Jesus Christ is. Now listen, if you look at that verse back in verse 6, it says it is the Spirit who bears witness. That verb is in the present tense, meaning that the Spirit of God is still doing the same thing. He is working in people's hearts, convincing them and persuading them and drawing them to God to show them that Jesus Christ is clearly the Messiah. And people today are seeing this is true. And many are coming to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. Now, if someone were to ask me, "Pastor, why are you a Christian?" Maybe someone might ask you that question. What would you say to them? Why are you a Christian? Well, I hope you have an answer for that, right? If you don't, you should take the class that we offer. We have an evangelism explosion class that we just got done doing, and then we'll offer it later on. But you need to learn how to answer those kind of questions, right? Well, what would you say? Well, if someone were to ask me that question, I would say, well, I'm a Christian, number one, because I really believe what the Bible says to be true. I believe it, and so that's why I'm a Christian. But really, if you've been listening to what I've been saying, the real reason why anyone's a Christian is because the Holy Spirit has opened up your eyes. The Holy Spirit has opened up your eyes to discern and to believe that Jesus is truly the Christ, and you believe that he is the Savior. You love Jesus Christ because he saved you, and then you want to build your life on his teachings because he is truly the Savior of all mankind. Amen? Now, the Holy Spirit helped me by testifying to me in my heart that these things are true. But listen to this. Knowing the facts and embracing them are two different things. It is one thing to acknowledge the facts. It is another thing to embrace the truth that those facts proclaim. It is a completely different thing. And so God is calling forth his witnesses. He calls forth the witness of his baptism. He calls forth the witness of the crucifixion. And now he calls forth the witness of the Holy Spirit. And he says, will you believe God's testimony concerning his Son? Fourthly, if you look at verse 9, God's going to call forth himself. He's going to bring forth the witness of the Father. Now, he doesn't have to do that, right? Right? He doesn't have to do that. But if you look at verse 9, it's kind of like a rebuke. He says, if you receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater, for this is the witness of God which he has testified concerning his son. Now, I read that earlier about Deuteronomy 19, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, a matter shall be established, right? The law says that a matter shall be believed if two or three witnesses are brought forth. John is saying that according to the law, you believe, right? If a witnesses are brought forth, you would believe. And so listen, this is what I want you to catch this now. God has brought forth three witnesses so far to testify of Jesus being his son. The water, the blood, and then the Holy Spirit. And these three, the word of God says, agree. So if you believe man, the question is to all of us, and some of us who are struggling with this, why won't you believe God? Why won't you believe God? God's testimony is greater. God's testimony is greater because God would never lie. It would go against his nature to lie. And there are some who with all the facts that we've laid out and all the facts that God gives to them of God's testimony regarding his son, they still won't believe. No matter how much evidence you give to a person, no matter how much God reveals to them, they still will not believe. They'll say, I need more evidence. I need more data. And then if I get more evidence and more data, then I'll believe. I'll believe. Well, listen, the issue that proves that the issue is not the evidence. It's not the data. There's plenty for those who are being drawn by the Father and who are searching to believe. God has already spoken. He has given ample evidence for all the world to believe that Jesus Christ is truly his son. And so the problem is not with the evidence. The problem is in our hearts. The problem is in our hearts. We have hearts that are full of sin. And God's word is saying, if you believe man, why won't you believe God? John says, God's word says, God has never lied to you. He's never said something that's not true. So the question is, can you trust God? Can you trust his word? And I hope you say, yes, I do believe. I do trust God. So the water, the blood, and the spirit all are a testimony from God to you. Now listen, all of this evidence is given, and people still don't believe. So therefore, unbelief is not something to be pitied. Unbelief is not something to be pitied, but a sin to be deplored. It's not something to be pitied. It's a sin to be deplored and avoided. Unbelief. Now, we're not talking about people who have no evidence, who have no witness. We're talking about people who know all the facts. They understand the baptism. They understand the crucifixion. The Holy Spirit's been working in their heart and telling them that these things are true, and they still won't believe. They still won't believe. Unbelief is not something to be pitied. It's a sin to be deplored. And so God is saying, believe his testimony regarding his son. Fifthly, in verse 10, he says, he who believes in the son has the witness in himself. And what he's saying there is now he's bringing forth the witness of conversion. The witness of conversion. If you have the son of God living in you, he's saying you have the witness in you. You have the witness in you. The witness that God has given you, that this is true. It's living inside you for all to see. Amen? And so this witness that he's talking about is what the Holy Spirit produced in a person's life. The moment a person believes and puts their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, a witness comes inside them, not the Jehovah Witnesses, okay? We're talking about a real witness that's living inside you that is true. Now, we've been talking about this because we're in chapter 5 of 1 John, right? And so we've been looking at what are some of the evidences, and you don't have to yell it out loud, one or two of you might, the rest of you are just real quiet because you're kind of shy, right? But God has been given to us witnesses that we've been studying in 1 John, right? Witnesses that are in us. One witness is this, that believers show that they have Christ living in them because they walk in the light as he is in the light, right? Why do they walk in the light? Because they have their sins are forgiven. Their sins are forgiven. They don't have the same relationship with sin that they did before. Their life has changed. They feel differently about sin. They don't like it. Before they got saved, before they became a Christian, hey, sin and them, well, buddies, man, let's go out and party and have some fun, right? But once your eyes are open to how sin messes up your life and separates you from God, and you understand that Jesus died for your sins, and now you want to get away from that. With God's help, he does that, right? And so we walk in the light as he is in the light. What other kind of witnesses are you given to us? We have the ability to love God, to obey the commandment to love God, and to love people who we're not related to. We love God and we love his people. That is a witness from God put in you, giving you the ability to love God and to love your brother and sister who are not really related to you. It's a wonderful testimony that God has given in your heart. Not only that, but we're able to walk in righteousness. We have a moral code that we want to live by. We don't want to walk in wickedness. We want to walk in righteousness. And fourthly, as we've been going through this book, it revealed to us that the fact that the witness is that we have faith, a faith that we didn't have before. We believe that Jesus is the Christ. And by believing, not only are we born again, but as I said last week, we're overcomers. We've become an overcomer. It's a wonderful, wonderful result of believing in Jesus. Amen? And so God, the Holy Spirit, has convinced you and I, who are believers, the truth of who Christ is. So you look at the objectable truth, the water, the crucifixion, right? The Holy Spirit is working in your heart, and by believing in the truth, you get subjective experience. Subjective experience, truth, to connect with the objective truth. Together, they reveal to you that what you know is true, and you believe it, and you stand on it as a solid ground, believing that Jesus Christ is truly who he says he is. And so the witness that God brings forth to the witness stand is the witness of conversion. Your life has been changed. And so he's saying to all of us, reminding us, believe the witness of conversion. There are countless of Christians all over the world who can stand up at that witness stand and testify, just like some of you can today, that you've been converted. That your life was a certain way at one time, but now it's changed because Jesus is living in you. You have the witness in yourself. Or do you? That is the question that all of us have to answer. Do you have that witness in your own heart, the witness of conversion? So believe the witness of conversion. If you don't have it, look at people you know who are saved. You know what their life was before, and look at their life now. Don't just say, oh, they're weird, radical Jesus freaks, right? No. Something happened in their life, and now they've been converted. They're believers in Christ, and it's a great witness and testimony. Lastly, in verses 11 and 12, we have the witness of eternal life. The witness of eternal life. Listen to what he says here in verses 11 and 12. And this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. And so the final witness that God is bringing forward for the world to know and for the church to be encouraged by this is the witness of eternal life. He who has the Son has eternal life. Now notice something about this word and about the way this is being phrased. Eternal life is not something that a person gets later. It is true that when a person dies, if they have eternal life now, they will live with God forever and ever in heaven. That is true. But he is saying that eternal life is a quality of life that a believer has, that when they put their trust in Jesus Christ, they're given a certain quality of life, and it's called eternal life. And you have that right now. It's not something that you have to wait for. You possess eternal life right now. It is the best insurance that you can have because this quality of life is designed to last forever and ever with God now and forever and ever for all eternity. This type of life will also prepare you. It will prepare you for heaven. It is meant to be built on. How do you build on that life? Through your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'll mention this again because this is important. Eternal life is given to us. Remember when we talked about that we are overcomers. And what do overcomers do? They overcome. And the reason why you overcome is because you have eternal life. You have a quality of life about you because you are a believer. It doesn't begin later. It begins the moment you trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You have eternal life, and it makes you an overcomer. You overcome sin. Doesn't mean you're perfect, but you're in a new direction in life. You overcome Satan. He's no longer bullying you around and telling you how to live your life. You're over Satan. And then finally, as we learned last week, we are over this world. This world does not have dominion over us anymore. We're overcomers. Now, verse 12 is a reality check. Listen to what this says. This is really, really, it's somewhat sad. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. This is a reality that so many people are faced with. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have, or she who does not have the Son, does not have life. This is equivalent to saying that if you don't have this life that he's talking about, that you are truly a walking dead person, spiritually dead to the things of God. That's sad. No matter how healthy you are, no matter how happy you are, if you don't have the life that he's talking about, because you don't have Jesus, you don't really have life. You might think you have life, but according to God's word, you don't have life. The life that God offers is eternal life, life that can come into you right now and change your life and make you a whole brand new person. And only God can do that. God can take your life and turn your life around. And all you got to do is believe his testimony. Believe his testimony concerning his Son. And by believing that testimony, you have life. And so as you bring this message to a close, the challenge is for all of us is, do you believe? Do you believe God's testimony regarding his Son? And if you don't, will you believe? Will you believe the testimony of the water, of the blood, of the Spirit, the testimony from the Father himself, the testimony of conversion, and the testimony of eternal life? And if that's something that you desire this morning, as I close in prayer, if you desire to have this life that God is offering to you, turn to God in prayer. Between you and him, God knows your heart. Turn to him in prayer and confess your need. Confess your need for that life. Confess your need for his forgiveness. Put your trust in the Son of God who came for you, seeking to save that which was lost, and he hung on a cross for 6 long hours and took the punishment that you deserve for your sins. God wants to save you, but he's not going to twist your arm. He's not going to make you do it. The Holy Spirit's going to open up your eyes and convince you of the truth. But it's your choice to believe. It's your choice to believe. And I pray you do. If you already are a believer and you already have eternal life, then God's message to you is rejoice. Praise God. Be thankful that God has opened up your eyes and revealed to you who his Son is. And then, as you hear me say over and over again, don't keep it to yourself. Share it. Share it with somebody. Share it with somebody. Because God's word is saying that this is the only way a person can be saved. This is the only way a person can have eternal life, is by believing in the Son of God. There's not many saviors out there. God has given one savior. His name is Jesus. Jesus. Do you have him? If you don't, as I close in prayer, you call out to him this morning. Trust him as your Lord and Savior. God will come into your heart. Christ will come into your heart. He will forgive you of all your sins. wash away your sins and to make you a child of God. That's a wonderful thing. So as I close in prayer, why don't we all bow our heads and close our eyes? Music people are going to come up. Just ignore them. Just think about what you heard. Think about the message that God has given to you this morning, a message of God's testimony concerning his son. Where do you stand spiritually? What is your spiritual need? You talk to God. Worship him now. Let's all be silent. Bow our heads, close our eyes. Think about what you heard. Oh God, thank you for being so merciful to us. Thank you for this testimony that you've given to us, for us to behold. Oh God, thank you for opening up my eyes. I pray all these people that are here this morning, I pray that their eyes have been opened up to the truth concerning your son Jesus. He is the only Savior, the only way, the only truth, the only life. No one can get to God the Father without going through Jesus. I pray, God, that today, if someone didn't know that, didn't believe it, they're confessing to you right now their need to be saved. That they see themselves as a sinner, and they believe that Jesus is the only Savior. And I know, God, that you will come into them right now and be in them. Their body will become your temple. You will be with them forever and ever. You give them eternal life, and you will never forsake them. Oh, God, may that be true in everyone's heart across this room. And if there's someone today that needs to be saved, needs to call out to you, may they do that. God, I pray for your encouragement for each one here. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As we continue worshiping the Lord, continue and realizing what we just heard this morning, we're going to sing a song to the Lord. It's an invitational song. It's going to come up on the screen, and I ask for all of us to stand up while we sing this song together. And if God has worked in your heart and you would like to pray, you can slide out of your pew, kneel down here. If you'd like to talk to me and say, Pastor, you know, I'm not sure of that message. I need Jesus Christ, and I trust him. I trusted him just now to save me. You can come and tell me that, and we'll make sure we've got some information that we'll give to you to help you along your way. But we want to make sure everybody here knows the Lord and is encouraged. You can stand up. It really is true. I meant it. Everybody can stand up. It's okay. Some of you guys don't want to stand up, but you want to wait for that last second. Oh, here we go.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Yeah.